so much. Thanks, Jason. This is the panel. Every startup that has talked about data and working with utilities today is waiting for. It's with Karen Cohen of CPS Energy. She's the CIO, and I'll invite her up to the stage now. As you know, with all the other panels and sessions, please put your questions in Slido, and we'll make sure we get to them. Yeah.
Great.
Thanks so much, Karen.
Shay. Thanks for having me here.
What we'll do is ask you to share your background and your deep expertise in the industry before we dive into the data-related questions here.
Okay, well, this will be the two-minute drill because I don't want to put anybody to sleep. So I was born in Michigan. It's important. Any other Michiganders out there? Show your mitt. Oh, yeah. I knew I'd find one. So I was born in Michigan. Started out, actually, my career in the pharmaceutical business. I helped bring Prozac to market, and that's when I got my feet wet into analytics. Back then, it wasn't called predictive and prescriptive, but believe me, you were dealing with people's lives, so you got that right. And from there, I had a whirlwind. Eventually, worked for the Doughboy for a while, and so I was an officer at Pillsbury before General Mills bought us. So I had my time in CPG, consumer products goods, and I learned how to take products to market and manage a P&L. And then from there, I ended up going to Chicago and decided to play with Exelon for a while. So it was right when Pico Energy and ComEdison came together. I worked for two CEOs, Corbin McNeil and John Rowe. I don't recommend that to anybody, but it was a great learning experience for me and learning all the facets of energy. And then US Cellular plucked me away from there to help them build out their 4G network and to launch Joan Cusack for my Chicagoans, rename Comiskey Park and get raked over the coals for that. And so that was pretty much my whirlwind. And from there, I launched a practice for 10 years and traveled the globe, helping people with digital presence and with distributed ways of doing things, if you will, and really introducing more technology convergence from the personalization aspects of it. And while I was global consulting, I ran into an old friend, Doyle Beneby, used to run CBS Energy, and Paul Gold-Williams had just taken over as CEO. And we met, and history was made. Pretty cool lady. I recommend anybody hang with her. She's just a blast. So I am now in San Antonio, moved there most recently from Seattle, where I spent 5 years, and I'm loving every minute of it. So my background really is math, science. I'm pretty much a math head, and I like to dabble in a lot of technology, but not for the sake of technology. If it doesn't have relevance or purpose, I'm not sure why we do it. I mean, anybody play with a rector set? Okay, but do you really use that today? Maybe. So that's a little bit about me.
Great, thanks so much. Provides a ton of context for the next question. Which, as we discussed on the setup call, who owns the data? Who in this utility industry of today, and truly the one we are all trying to create in here, who owns that data?
Well, it depends on from whose point of view that you're talking. And we all know that. But if you are a customer, how many here, show of hands, believe they own their personal data? Anybody? Yeah? Do you protect it fiercely? How many don't? How many don't think they own their personal data? Fair. So I would tell you that it depends on what type of data it is. It depends on what risk factor. There's a pendulum there that you have to manage to. And so I believe you're going to continue to see, there's fragmentation in this now, but a lot of data brokers emerge, and you're going to see more and more. The digital giants have been there for a while, and they've been trying to do that. But those brokers don't necessarily always have the legal rights, depending on if you're looking at federal or state regulation, right? So you have to have your regulators involved. I mean, look what's happened with the EU, with some of the things they're doing with GDPR. So we basically are having a changing world now, and I think because the world's becoming much smaller, we're going to have to be adaptive, and we're going to have to be really smart about it. So for those folks like myself, we're a public records company, a municipal energy utility, as I think most of you know, of energy and gas. So everything's discoverable, right? However, we do fiercely protect our customer data. Any PII information must be protected at all costs. So as we start to get into data sharing and we try to garner information from things, whether those, you know, your endpoint strategy, your meters, whatever, those types of regulations and laws, I think, are going to be established based on usage, based on distribution and consumption. So I think there are a lot of different owners, and I do not believe that we should get too set on that. Further, most of the younger generation that are entering the world now, some even in the womb, come out and they don't mind sharing. Mm-hmm. Most people don't mind sharing at all. I mean, the really old boomers, they're like secret squirrel. I can't share it with you because I might turn into a bumpkin. So we, you know, we have to look at the pendulum that's occurred there too. And I think as you segment society, you're going to see that change.
Yeah, and so I guess in a world where the context of the customer starts to matter, who it is and who owns the data, what role? Because it sounds like, and as far as we can all tell, the utility has played the protector role mm-hmm. for so long. In a world where you lose, in some cases anyway, where you lose that self-appointed, in some cases, regulation required,
yes.
in some cases, mm-hmm. role, what is there a business model for data for the utility? And if the answer is yes or no, how can startups that are looking to either work with the utility or in some cases disrupt the utility, how are you setting up to engage with them?
That's a great question. So one, I would say that yes, historically, whether it's utilities in general, I mean, it could be telecommunications,
yes.
it could be any of them, very protective, and there's going to be an element that I think always exists there. After all, it is the grid, and we protect it fiercely at all costs, and we'll continue to do that. Mm-hmm. So the grid is paramount. When you come off from there, the role that we play is I prefer to migrate us from ultimate protector to steward mm-hmm. and to advisor. And so if it's data that we originate, if it's data that we're learning about human behavior in your smart homes and between all your devices, there's a case to be made that we could actually, as you opt in, become a broker for bringing that information back to you to improve your business operation if it's B2B or to improve your livelihood if you're in a smart home. And I believe we have the capability of doing that. So to me, that's a innovative, more steward versus protector, and yet by law, regulation, and other factors that come into there, you have to be adaptive and you have to be able to make adjustments as is required. So I believe that CPS Energy is becoming more of a very progressive energy company that's well adept at technology and analytics. Mm-hmm. And that would in and itself suggest that we will continue to lean heavily into exploring our role as data stewards.
And so as we now have situations where SolarCity has my energy usage data.
Yep.
Nest understands everything that's going on in my home, mm-hmm. frankly, because yes, it is energy efficiency, but it notices when you walk past occupancy and things of that nature. They've already, for lack of a better word, taken over some of the role you are still working on trying to play.
Mm-hmm.
Is there room for collaboration there? Where do you see the...
I actually think there is. I think there's extensive room. I mean, let's put it this way. Everything is pretty much an ecosystem. Mm-hmm. So if you look at data as an ecosystem in terms of how it originates, again, how it disseminates, how it's disposed. I mean, data has a life cycle like anything else, yeah. some controlled by law. But I think that it becomes very easy with that. So you're always, in my opinion, and especially for startups, here's my counsel for one thing since it just popped in my head
before
it flies out. If you're looking at creating a product that's really innovative that you really want to change the market or create the market for, be thinking up front all the usability of that data or that information that whatever you're building, whether it's a component, whether it's software, whether it's controls, whatever it is, think about how that's going to be used and consumed within the new ecosystem that you interject in, and that could be a really big differentiator for you, because that's where I would say we have nothing but opportunity. I don't see restriction. I don't see it as competitive. If we can get information from the Nest products and we can, again, become an aggregator with LG's products and with all the others, I mean, building management systems, why not? You know, get in and start being it, because where we want to be is powering it. We want to be the people that power that, and so you have to understand it. And if you have an opportunity within your core business to collect that information and prove that you are a great advisor but also a very credible steward of it, I think people might even, it could even go so far as monetization.
Oh, so you think there's a business model there?
I think there is a business model there for sure. So first I said framework, and I meant that, because we're in a maturity model.
Yeah.
And I think that could evolve its way into an infonomics framework that, that would become more of a business model.
Fantastic. And do you see this purely as an energy data play or additional context? 'Cause,
it's a great question. Yeah. So I personally believe that we have an opportunity to enrich lives. CPS Energy has a people-first strategy that we are incredibly passionate about. And it's about our employees, it's about our customers, and it's about our community at large that we serve, which includes all the way up the corridor with our friends at Austin or anyone else. If there's something that we can do that benefits the way people live, that connect people, that help them take advantage of some of these incredible technologies that maybe allows them to spend a little more quality of life because they're not constantly having to collect something. It's there for them, and it's not making them have to work so hard to just run day-to-day life.
Mm-hmm.
I don't think that's so bad. At the end of the day, though, we still predominantly need to make sure that it's reliable energy, safe energy, right? And it's there when you need it and when you expect it, and we have to bill it affordably.
Yes. And do you see any, I guess, the downsides of that? Just some initial thoughts, because the further away from the core value you provide that you move, the more open you are to competition, frankly, from some of the brokers and the aggregators of data that you were talking about. But also, I guess, at what point does regulation hit the opportunities that you see for the data? Is it stifling what you could do? Is there a willingness to
we have very, very specific laws we have to abide by statewide and otherwise.
Yeah.
And luckily we have an incredibly talented chief legal counsel, Carolyn Shellman, who keeps us on the straight and narrow. She's on the ERCOT board. She understands what we can and can't do more than anybody. I'm, you know, I've got a path in the carpet drawn between our offices, because anything we're thinking about doing, for example, right now we're partnering with a lot of our civic partners, right? So whether it's the transportation group with VIA, or whether it's the water group with SAWS, or whether it's COSA themselves, which is City of San Antonio, we partner with them on a lot of different things. We like shared assets if we can do it, you know, because that brings everybody's costs down for their community at large. So there's even some governmental master interlocal agreements we're working on right now that help us better exchange and share assets so that we can better that community and everybody doesn't have to build one of their own. So I think as long as we play within the legal sandbox that we're supposed to, we can still learn a lot. We can still bring in partners and alliances to help us with this vision of what we could do with data. But let there be no mistake. We're not looking to go out and become, you know, a replacement for a carrier or a replacement for a big data house. We just want to make sure that whatever data we are lucky enough to be able to manage and steward for our collection of customers could be leveraged elsewhere in the community.
That's great.
Does that make sense?
It does. It does. Yeah. And I guess we can sort of tie that back to startups a bit, because many of the business models of the disruptive startups here today, a few of them anyway, touch on that data, your data right now, because a few of them are on the distribution and transmission side. How much of, because it sounds like to me the bulk of the conversation so far has been on the customer side, how much of your proprietary managing the business of getting power to people's homes on the grid, how much of that type of data is available for partnerships?
That one I'm not entirely sure on. I can tell you that from a demand response point of view, it could be and is. So for example, San Antonio Police Department or so. I mean, if you're doing demand response or if you're out making sure that you're just taking care of the community during a catastrophic event or a storm of some, or something of that nature, you're going to be able to have opportunities to share some of that, right? Mm-hmm. But at the end of the day, we're very, very focused in that arena. Mm-hmm. And we're wanting to make sure that, as an example, our advanced analytics group that happens to report in through me is working on an outage management predictive solution right now that's going to allow us to tell a customer that their power is fine. I mean, it's going to go out, but we took care of it for them proactively, and it's mm-hmm. just a quick agent to their phone that lets them know that. So there's a lot of things that we're starting to work on that help us take patterns mm-hmm. and algorithms together that are all around not just the customer experience, but the operational excellence that we want to achieve in the field for safety.
Yeah.
Safety first for us, zero harm, right?
Yeah.
So that even applies to all of our linemen and journeymen. We want to be able to have intelligence in there. What happens if somebody's walking up to do some work on a substation and they pull out their device and their device reminds them right there everything they're supposed to do by the playbook?
Mm-hmm.
They don't have to remember,
mm-hmm.
even though many of them do, right? So,
yeah.
I mean, there's so many different relevant cases to what you can do when you start to combine patterns of information in a predictive way.
Which, I guess, to a slight addition to that question, we're starting to see a few more open source initiatives.
Mm-hmm.
Any thoughts on that before I dive into specific questions? That
it's a landscape that's a bit fragmented right now that is good to watch. So OpenSCADA, a lot of the other things we have out there. We have our whole SCADA platform right now that we're evaluating because of its age. I'm sure other people have seen that in the industry. And we're not different than anybody else other than the fact that we're trying to look at where the puck's going to be versus where it is. So it'd be really easy to just go out and start, you know, spinning up V-blocks or, you know, doing something to try to make it more robust. And instead, we're looking at it very, very different from that and saying, how will we manage our control systems? You know, what do those really need to look like for the future state of a distributed energy environment?
Mm-hmm.
And if we're now helping other customers with their power in their homes and we're a broker that helps them resell that power, whatever we end up doing, we've got to be thinking about all of that as we look for those open systems. And that's another recommendation to any of the entrepreneurial folks in here is stay very open. You know, the days of proprietary and, you know, it's something that I'm going to do unique and I'm going to be so rich doing it, I think those days are over. And so everything needs to be extraordinarily open and we need to be thinking about where it will connect with an ecosystems of the future.
Yeah, that's a fascinating coming from, like, it's not typical to hear a utility executive tell startups to be open because the accusation is that the utilities aren't.
Well, I'm not my grandfather's utility.
That's great to hear. That's great to hear. So send your pitch decks to CPS Energy after this.
There you go.
Yeah. I'll pause now if there are any questions from the audience. I hope the startups have questions because you have a decision maker sitting right here.
Hi. Depends on what you and I negotiate. So at the end of the day, I own any data that you originate off my premises. And, if you want, and we can talk all about that and board it. But what it comes down to is there's certain data that becomes public and available to anybody and should because it enriches lives. And so you have to really get down to the specifics of what that's going to look like. Now, I'm big into partnerships, so I don't want you to think I'm competing with you. I'm an energy company. I'm not a data analytics company. I just want to be extraordinarily gifted at predictive analytics. So if you accelerate my ability to do that, we would get into those negotiations. How many here have ever heard of a tiny little company called iTron in the room? So for those of us that use iTron, they're basically running our meter system, right? So what are we doing with all that data? It's customer data. Whose data is it? Do I pay coming? Do I pay going? You know, these are all the types of things that really smart leaders and organizations look at, because you're trying to understand, again, back to that ecosystem. I can't overuse that term because it's so true. You look at where networks are moving. You look at where data is moving. You look at where you're trying to predict all types of things, weather data, all kinds of things coming in, right? And so those enablers have to be governed a bit by business models. And so it would depend on what we decided, the exact services that you suggested to us, and then we'd sit down and talk about that openly and transparently.
Any other questions? And there's one back there.
California recently passed a consumer privacy act. I was just wondering if you had any thoughts on that, and whether Texas would be following suit sometime soon, and how do you prepare for that?
Well, I'm not sure Texas is a fast follower in that regard compared to California, my experience, but I could be wrong on that. California is California, and a lot of people try to put it in its little, you know, cocoon, because nobody's like California, and yet there's so much to be learned from California. So I believe that we're still going to have the West leading across the Mid and the East, and we will too end up following to some degree, right? Will Texas law, you know, adopt that or do that in the next year or two? I don't have a crystal ball that would be clear on that for you. But I have others in my organization that look at that every day, and we continue to analyze where government's moving and where policy's moving, and we try to get in the front end of that, which is why we have an office right here in Austin. A woman named Kathy Garcia does an exceptional job of running our government relations group, and that's what they're all about. So I would tell you that Texas has, I think, a lot of great opportunity. It's unique. I mean, I've been in Illinois and Michigan. I've lived in 7 states and 2 countries. So I look at where Texas is at and just how we're put together, and I think we have incredible opportunity to be more progressive in that regard. However, I'm not the one sitting making the law.
While everyone's thinking, something just popped in my head. And you've shared a few thoughts and ideas about how, if a company wants to work with CPS Energy, some of the things they shouldn't do. Is there, do you have an approach that you'd suggest they take in coming to you, especially as it comes to the customer experiences? Because on the operation side, I'm sure there's a lot you can handle. But truth is, most utilities can't do user experience and those journeys as well as some digitally savvy.
Yep, it's a great question. So one, we are not unlike anybody else. We are on a mission to build out a very deliberate digital wrapper around our business. To do that, we need help with personas and journey maps. We need help with segmentation. We're already undergoing that. So customer segmentation, I think, is pretty critical. And for any of you entrepreneurs, always know your customers and segment them, because one size doesn't fit all in any industry. Unless you maybe sell flamingos on a lawn, but I don't think anybody in the room does that. But most businesses are more complex than that, so you have to understand your targeted audience and then gear all your inertia towards that. So I think that we basically are at a point in time where anybody that wants to do business with us and come in the front door, we've created a center for innovation. It's held by a gentleman named Jason Scarlett. Jason, can you stand up so people can see who you are? So Jason does report to me, and I have innovation analytics. I have portfolio management, which is for every dollar you invest, what return do you get, and then IT. So Jason's heading up the innovation center for innovation for us. There's also a few others. Simon, are you in the audience? I don't know where he's at. Yep, Simon Costello. So Simon heads up our economic development area. with David Youngman. These guys partner all the time. We have multiple front doors because we need to, right? We probably have a few back doors too for those with relationships. But we have very definite front doors, and we're just not very good about communicating that. We'll get better at it. So both Simon and Jason are people that you can contact. They know how to navigate the CPS energy culture. They know who to bring to the table and when. And so I would encourage that. We also have a wonderful partner in the room, Kimberly. Did I see Kimberly in here? So Kimberly is the CEO of Epicenter, who we love dearly and who we promote always, and she promotes us. Kisses. She's also another door to come in, and we would do anything we could to promote anyone's ideas, endeavors. I mean, this Center for Innovation is about that. Bring an idea. Bring it on. No idea is a bad idea. Whether it's relevant for us right now, we've got to vet that. But we're very, very open, and it's why we spend so much time in these kinds of forums. Hope that helps.
I can imagine it did.
Sorry, Simon, Jason, you guys might know a little bit more.
Any other questions from this? I can't actually see
know,
too well.
I know, these lights.
There's a light here. His, I guess, sort of tangentially touching on, I believe someone was saying something about regulatory. How much of that do you need to see from the companies, or the understanding of that do you need to see from the companies who come to partner with you? Because they could probably get access to some of that customer data on the customer side now.
Sure.
I'll go back to that. What do you need them to have factored in to come sit at the table with you?
That's a great question. So one, we would never know everything ourselves even if we tried to. Mm. So we need help. We need an ecosystem of partners so that everybody's looking at the regulations that are there and are emerging so that we can make sure that we're making the right bets.
Mm.
So example, we already mentioned a little bit about GDPR and the fact that EU has made a statement.
Yeah.
I mean, I believe that was just May of 18.
Just
May of 18. So that's the beginning of, a series of these things you're going to see. Anybody that wants to play with us on the data front had better know that, had better be well-versed in security and cyber practices, had better absolutely be able to come in with a list of credentials that says, yep, I did my homework, and if I'm going to come in and I'm lucky enough, privileged enough, to be let in the door to work with CPS Energy's data, they're going to have to prove all that. And then they got to continue to keep us wise, and we will them. I mean, we look at things as partnerships.
Mm.
So I think people that do business with us gain from us. They walk away with more IP or experiences, and we equally do them. And so it is a partnership, but I think we have to have a little bit of role clarity. If I'm buying something as a service because
mm-hmm.
everything's moving to microservices,
mm-hmm.
I don't plan to buy a microservice and then have to go build my own security protocols and have to follow my own. I mean, I'm going to do it anyway because we're smart people and we always study what's going on around us across the globe.
Yes.
But I would expect somebody to already come really well versed in that in each of those areas.
That's great. I think we have just a couple of minutes. I'll step back a little. What role do you see CPS and most utilities? What role do you think the utility plays in the smart cities and the cities of the future that we're all not quite sure, but starting to see in some cases?
Yeah, so that's a really great question, and I don't know how many of you guys out there are following this, but it really depends on how you're structured. Are you a municipality?
Mm.
Are you governed by a council? I mean, how do you run?
Mm.
So one, you got to look at the governance structure of each city.
Mm.
And then that doesn't get in your way. You just need to understand it so you can navigate it and so you understand decision rights. Because I don't know how many of you guys have ever had to go through a city council to get approval on something, but it takes time.
Yeah.
And you have to socialize and shop your idea around many, many times before you ever get in front of them. And you have to be relevant all the time. And then when you change one out, everything changes again, right? Because for points of view change. So I would say, one, get that right. Understand how to navigate. But from a smart city perspective, if you're in really well with the decision makers of those cities, and if you have a progressive mayor with a really clear agenda, I think that utilities can play an incredible role in enabling. Puget Sound Energy is an example. We're doing an incredible amount of work with Bellevue right now, but they're not doing much with Seattle. They barely even really deal with them much. And it's just, you know, they could. They just don't. But Bellevue's in their backyard, and so they do a lot with them. We are unique. 75 years we've been owned by the city of San Antonio, for those that don't know that. We are not an agency, but we are owned by the city of San Antonio. So we have a unique opportunity where we are because we have more of a regionalism concept where everybody's part of the family. I mean, I meet with the CIOs and others, the city manager and the assistant city managers on many, many things each week. I mean, I need one of those little scooters, and I just scoot down and up and down market, you know, going between City Hall and our building. And basically, we partner with them extensively because we're all contributing to the betterment of San Antonio. Mm. You know, seventh largest city, growing like gangbusters, and we're all equally committed. So when you have a common goal like that, how you get there may deviate. But it's a common goal. And so I think energy companies that are sitting back and waiting on the fence are missing great opportunities to better their community.
Thanks so much. We're pretty much out of time. Will you join me in thanking? So I believe there's a short break now, and okay. I'll just look through. It's a 30-minute break, apparently. Grab a drink, network, use the bathrooms, check out the demos downstairs again, and there'll be one panel that starts at 3:30 right after this. Thank you. When you hear the chimes, please come back upstairs.